Princeton University Press Audio presents American Afterlives, Reinventing Death in the 21st Century by Shannon Lee Dawdy. Read by Kelly Burke. Preface. Each book I write seems to get a little odder than the last one. This is not on purpose. Perhaps it reflects a process of gradually letting go, of conventions, of anxieties, of expectations, of being at peace with who I am as a writer and a thinker and trusting that someone out there will get it. This book has brought a lot of peace. It's been an unintended existential journey. I can comfortably say now that I am okay with dying. Don't worry, I'm not planning on it. But then, almost no one does. When I fly, I often think to myself, if I die today, it'll be fine. I've had a pretty good run. Death is the natural ending of every life. It is strange how hard we humans fight that fact. We cause ourselves a lot of needless anxiety and suffering. I'm not sure what the experience of listening to this odd little book will be for the listener, especially in the aftermath of a devastating pandemic. But my wish is that some of this peace will rub off on you. In fact, it is okay to laugh, to smile, to take comfort here. Gallows humor is easy. It's the nervous laugh of the uninitiated. But I mean something more deep-bellied and Buddha-like. It's hard to work on death and not have people assume you're a goth princess or dispositionally morose, or that your work is going to bring them down. I've come to believe that embracing the realities of death can make our hearts lighter, not heavier. As Esmeralda, one of my interviewees, said, it's all a point of view. This book is odd for a couple different reasons, so let me prepare you just a little. First, although I have a doctorate and I'm cross-trained in anthropology, archaeology, and history, this is not meant to be an academic book for a specialist audience. I have written a few articles out of this material for my scholarly peers, and I have a few more ideas to throw at them in these pages, but the material here, and my journey with it, was too rich not to share more broadly. I can't help an anthropological curiosity about what makes people tick, but I have tried to translate terms and invite the listener in. It did not feel right to write an impersonal account about death. That's not how this project started for me, and that's not how it's ended for any of us. So the listener will find that I am present in these pages as a private, feeling person. This is an experiment. Can a book be both anthropological and accessible, both personal and intellectual? A second oddity. The writing emerged out of a 5-year process of making a documentary film. I met my talented co-director and cinematographer Daniel Zox by happenstance. We were squeezed into a minibus with others on a tour of rural Oaxaca in early 2015. I was teaching in a study abroad program. He was on vacation with his family. Over lunch, we discovered that we both lived in Chicago, so we stayed in touch. At that time, I had an idea that I wanted to do an archaeological ethnography of contemporary American death practices. One day, after talking to Daniel about his filmmaking, I realized that this topic could make an interesting film. I was pretty sure it would involve some interesting people, and visuals of deathscapes and artifacts were already running through my head. I pitched it to him over a Mexican brunch in my Chicago neighborhood. He said yes, and we were off running. Our time, our budget, and our ideas about the project ebbed and flowed over this 5-year period. We had no script. Most documentarians have some idea about the story they want to tell before they get started. I had no clue what was going on in American death practices, other than that they were rapidly changing. I wanted to learn more. For me, Filming was like collecting found objects until they start to assemble themselves into coherent patterns. We eventually collected over 200 hours of footage. This magpie approach is not the easiest or most cost-effective way to make a film. Perhaps you can't take the archaeologist out of the filmmaker. Daniel was patient with my steep learning curve and this exploratory method, which was new for him, too. It often felt like we were undertaking an old-fashioned expedition into unknown territory. Filmmaking was all new to me, and I loved most of it. It is physical and creative at the same time, with a necessarily intense camaraderie among the crew. That combination parallels the joyful labor of an archaeological dig. It was in the film editing process that the writing started to happen. At that point, I accepted that we had far too much material and too many storylines to fit into a single film. Films allow you to stretch and explore a topic, but they also need a tight focus to get ideas across. It is a more subtle medium than text. So what appears in this book is in part the cutting room floor, all those themes, characters, dialogues, and subplots that we couldn't fit into the 21-minute documentary we eventually produced. The film, I Like Dirt, zeroes in on contemporary California and the ways in which death care there reflects a particular regional culture. The scope of this book is larger and more cluttered, ranging across the American landscape and digging down into its historical roots. The quality of the research presented here is inseparable from its origins in the filmmaking process. I would be telling a lie if I pretended that this book emerged from a standard ethnographic inquiry. The writing at times probably has a cinematographic quality. A behind-the-scenes narrative makes it clear that many of the people I was speaking to were being filmed. Whenever I say we, I usually mean Daniel and myself, but about half of the time there was a third or even a fourth person there recording sound or assisting. I often simplify the point of view to I because I'm trying to get across what was going on inside my head when I was talking to someone, or to convey the particular dynamic between interviewer, me, and interviewee. But Daniel was always there, watching behind the camera, adding his own questions for people, and stirring the pot of ideas, often as we talked over a well-earned meal. And he is here in this book. I have already alluded to how my specialist training as an archaeologist affected the creative process, but it was my generalist training as an anthropologist that attuned me to ethical concerns. All the direct quotes in the book are transcribed either from audiovisual files made in the process of filming or from my written notes of one-on-one interviews conducted before or after filming, or independent of it. In terms of transcription editing, I cleaned up oral speech by eliminating ums, false starts, and awkward repetitions, and for the sake of textual flow, I eliminated ellipses, but never scrambled the order of statements. The principles I applied in editing quotes were be true to the speaker and be easy on the listener. The project as a whole was conducted under an approved institutional review board protocol from the University of Chicago. Everyone I interviewed was informed about the purpose of the research, and all interviewees gave their consent. I am immensely grateful for their candidness, vulnerability, and generosity of time. I hope they find it returned in some small way through my confessional narrative in the chapters that follow. If someone said something potentially controversial in a way that could come back to haunt them, I disguised their identity with a pseudonym or deliberate vagueness, if at all possible. But with many of the death care professionals I spoke to, their product or services are so unique that the internet, and in some cases our film, makes anonymity impossible. I followed informed consent protocols, but at times I went beyond them to follow my own protective instincts. I decided to use first names only for consistency, but also to treat people equally, from the homeless guy I talked to on the street to the millionaire CEO. Sometimes my instincts told me to turn the camera off. One example was while filming a man named Rod, whose story appears in Chapter 4. Rod had lost his wife several months earlier and became understandably emotional while filming. For me, it just didn't feel right to look at someone's grief so closely. But he didn't ask us to stop, which I had told him he had a right to do at any time. In the moment, I trusted Daniel, who kept rolling. Later, I struggled with my feelings over this scene, and we had to talk it over. Rod urgently and graciously wanted to share his story with us. Was my anxiety of letting him do it a holdover from an age when we were embarrassed to talk about death? Or, as an anthropologist, do I have an obligation to turn off the camera on the most vulnerable scenes of human experience? Rod's tears were contagious. I welled up too. This happened more than once during filmmaking, and I'm not a crybaby. Was my discomfort about losing observer detachment? I still don't know the answers to these questions. That's another reason I wanted to write this book. Not to lay out American society and my relationship to it like I'm some special authority, but because I feel an obligation to describe difficult truths and internal conflicts. As I finished the manuscript, the COVID-19 pandemic and its political reverberations were sweeping through the United States. Talk about difficult truths and internal conflicts. At first, I worried that I was going to have to rewrite the entire book in the face of a once-in-a-century mass death experience. I started to freeze. Then I realized two things that gave me the courage to keep going. First, I needed to remain true to my original impulse. For the most part, the cause of death, whether from a new virus or a toaster accident, does not matter to the story I tell here. My focus is on what happens to the body and the person after death. The before part is, of course, important in its own right. The big stories about how we live and how we die. But those aren't the types of conversations I initiated with people. I asked instead, what happens after? What do people want done with their body? What happens to us after life? Second, I can't predict the final impact of COVID-19 any better than an epidemiologist. It is going to write its own narrative. It will be years before we understand the full impact of the pandemic on American death practices and conceptions of the afterlife. All ethnographies and film documentaries are works of history. They cover a finite period of time. This book offers a snapshot of American death trends between 2000 and 2020. In late 2020, I checked in with my key interlocutors to see how they and their businesses had been affected. I've worked updates into the text as needed. More than that, the pandemic has left a watermark on this book because it has touched me personally. Daniel struggled with the lingering effects of the virus for months, as have several of my students and colleagues. Three people that I knew and was fond of died from it. Two of them before their time, as we say, though the right time can be so unclear. Like everyone, I live a disjointed life of uncertainty and isolation in 2020 and the first half of 2021. None of us will ever be the same. I didn't want to write a grim book about death. That is the biggest challenge COVID-19 has presented to completing this work. Getting the tone right during a time of devastating loss, while staying true to my intent to lighten our fears about mortality. I try to make my struggles visible here. Perhaps the biggest challenge of all is knowing when to let go of anything. A project, a person, a belief, or life as we know it. I hope the listener will join me in the process of letting go. Chapter 1. The Hole. It was Halloween night in the French Quarter of New Orleans. Daniel, my collaborator and co-director, set up his camera on the sidewalk in front of a costume wig shop, and the sound guy tested the boom mic. The wig shop was open late that night, busy with last-minute customers. As the sun began to set, couples and small groups of adult revelers, not yet drunk, started to stream past us. We were in the early experimental stages of making a documentary film. We probably looked like a low-budget TV news crew. We were out to do man-in-the-street interviews, or maybe witches, fairies, and unicorns in the street. Whomever we could find. I felt like a nervous streetwalker propositioning strangers. I was dressed as some sort of vaguely gothic lady in a black corset, hardly the strangest person on the street. But some people crossed over and avoided us anyway. I assume the camera and lights were the scary bit. Others were game to talk. Early in the evening, one young man walking by on his own paused to humor us. He was dressed completely in black, a suit, tie, and matching trench coat. He had a piece of black hosiery pulled over his head, topped by a fedora. The invisible man. I've been told I have a habit of looking too intensely into people's eyes when I talk to them. I passed my eyes like searchlights back and forth over his face, assessing its bumps and dents so I could make a reasonable guess about where his eyes were. Still, as we talked, I couldn't tell if he was looking back at me just as intently or staring off toward a vanishing point just beyond my shoulder. I warmed up by asking him to tell me his name and where he was from. Trevor talked fast and seemed uncannily prepared for my big question of the evening. What do you want done with your body when you die? Without a second's hesitation, he replied, I would like to figure out a way for me to legally just be put into a bayou. I don't want a grave. I don't want to be cremated. Just put my body in a bayou. Let it go back to the swamp. When it comes to a ceremony, he said, he wants to go straight to the wake and to be present for it. He said that's what they basically did for a friend of his who had recently died of cancer. They all came over to her house on her last weekend and cooked, talked, and played music before she said she was tired and went up to bed. Forever. His voice cracked as he finished telling me about his friend. I could see wet spots spreading over his form-fitting mask, even darker than the obscuring cloth. Those eyes I couldn't see started to weep. The invisible man was crying visible tears. I was moved to silence. All I could do was respect his sadness. He gathered himself. But, he said, that's how it should be. I thanked him and let him go on his way, hoping he was headed for a party with lighter spirits. I didn't get to my second question. What do you think happens to us after we die? This exchange has stayed with me. It represents the task I've set for myself, to ask nearly impossible questions. And the risk that I will set off a chain of the most delicate reactions, a trauma, an anxiety, an unhealed grief, or that most universal of existential crises, why are we here and what are we going to do about it? In that moment, I felt his grief. It echoed my own. We briefly connected in a way that violates the academic conceit that separates researcher and subject. Between 2008 and 2013, I lost four people I loved in the span of 5 years. as if I had drifted too close to a black hole. That was when I started asking people what they thought happened to us after we died, and what they wanted the living to do with their bodies. A lot of them want to be burned, to go out in a glorious blaze. Fire terrifies me, but many people I talk to say that we are just stardust anyway. I am not entirely certain that this book will be considered an anthropological one, much less an archaeological one, except that my profession gave me the arrogance to try to understand human experience by intruding into the private lives of others. But it's the only book I could write. A conventional academic genre about American afterlives in the 21st century would not only blur vivid experiences that I am trying to bring into focus, but in the context of the most devastating pandemic to strike in 100 years, be tactless. I need to honor those moments of connection that I felt with people like the Invisible Man. It would feel dishonest to disappear myself from the emotional events of fieldwork. I hate being photographed, so I do not appear in the camera frame during our interviews, but I will make myself visible here. I am not invisible. It was a couple of years before that Halloween night in 2015 that I started to think about doing a research project on contemporary American death practices. It was my way of dealing with the loss of 4 loved ones in 5 years. Each of those deaths was different and felt different. Yet in each case, the body was cremated, and there were decisions made and ceremonies created to handle the ashes, scattering, burying, making them into jewelry and bird baths, placing them in a biodegradable box destined for the river that ran through my childhood. Prior to that, I had never thought much about what happens after life. When the body takes an unrecognizable form as an inert shell, a biological and chemical assemblage on its way to morphing into something else. After the intense phases of grief had passed, I became interested in finding out more about what Americans were doing with the remains of their loved ones, and what this might say about their beliefs about who we are and what happens to us after death. Research, for me, is a form of emotional processing. I slowly began working on this project, first as a historical investigation, and then, after I met filmmaker Daniel Zox, as a documentary film that would capture and complement what I was trying to get down on paper. As I got deeper into the research, I realized that I had stumbled into a cultural field that was simultaneously falling apart and blossoming. Funeral director after funeral director that I talked to offered a version of what Stan, an entrepreneur who distributes novelty funeral paraphernalia, said to me in 2017. There have been more changes in the funeral business in the last 10 years than in the last 100. To this day, the most influential book ever written on the American death scene is British journalist Jessica Mitford's 1963 expose, The American Way of Death. Through investigative work in Southern California that retraced some of novelist Evelyn Waugh's steps in The Loved One, Mitford documented the ways in which the American funeral industry had standardized a rite of passage and professionalized what used to be a form of family care. She described and decried a distinctly American funeral complex characterized by the popularization of embalming, the open casket, fancy caskets, and expensive vault burials. This tradition had developed in the 1880s and spread through diverse urban and rural communities in the United States, becoming fully entrenched by the 1920s. In Mitford's view, the American death complex that came to dominate the 20th century amounted to a big con job. Like Waugh, she thought that embalming reflected American optimism gone haywire, that it expressed a denial that death happens at all. It's time for an update. Jessica Mitford still haunts funeral directors today. Poet mortician Thomas Lynch, in his 1997 memoir, The Undertaking, felt a need to exorcise her ghost, objecting to her claim that fussing over the dead body was barbaric, when in fact an embalmer could undo some of the psychic damage inflicted by a more barbaric murderer, citing a horrific case he was called to work on early in his career. As I read his defense of the dismal trade, it occurred to me that people in other countries may not be as familiar with death by homicide. Perhaps the repair work of embalming and restoration offers precisely the kind of death ritual that a violent society needs. The United States is also a strongly capitalist society. While Mitford seemed to think that no one should ever make a profit from death, she herself viewed death rituals with a cold, calculating, instrumentalist logic. She advocated strongly for low-cost, direct cremation, in which you pick up your loved one's ashes at the crematory in a cardboard box, eliminating the funeral director, whom she viewed as an unnecessary middleman between life and death. In her strong opinion, fussing over the dead was unseemly. It was as if American death offended her British sense of propriety. In my interviews, I've found that funeral directors are still trying to respond to Mitford's critique. Many of the non-professionals I spoke to uttered some trickle-down version of it. They don't want any fuss. They don't want to take up any space. They don't want to leave a financial burden. Her ideas have seeped through much of American society and encouraged the transition to cremation. That transition, though, was going slowly until about the year 2000, when it began to explode. Between 2000 and 2015, the U.S. cremation rate doubled, and now nearly 60% of all Americans choose this disposition of the body, as it's called. Not only are bodies being treated differently, more people are sidestepping the traditional funeral and inventing rituals of their own. Religious traditions long governed the disposition of the dead, but they are losing their monopoly. Most faiths have become more open to variation in funeral rites, while many Americans now define their beliefs about the human spirit in a highly individualized way, independent of organized religion. In the 21st century, death is being reinvented in the United States on three levels simultaneously: the disposition of human remains, new rituals, and ideas about the afterlife. There has been a tendency to view Western death culture as ordinary, shallow, secular. Contemporary funeral practices were presumed by many scholars to be boring and profane, sanitized and standardized. Today, these generalizations are untenable. Contemporary American death culture might be confusing in its innovations and pluralism, but it could not be said to be boring. Even before the COVID-19 pandemic, death was having a moment in the public sphere. You can mix your loved one's ashes into a vinyl record that plays a recording of their voice. You can live on through a software program timed to send messages to your family from the beyond. You can have your body frozen, incinerated, buried in a redwood grove, plastinated, dissected for science, or dissolved in chemicals. Soon, you can be composted in a steaming pile of wood chips on an urban lot. Your family can take some of your cremated remains and incorporate them into jewelry, artificial reefs, or paperweights. It is increasingly acceptable not only to personally handle the corpse, but to continue to live with a piece of it long after the end of biological life. And it's becoming more acceptable, or once again acceptable, to talk to the dead, to celebrate their birthdays, or to leave a bottle of beer on their grave. American Afterlives explores rapidly changing death practices in the 21st century United States. It asks, What does the changing face of death tell us about American beliefs and values at this historical juncture? Between 2015 and 2020, I traveled the United States from Vermont to California, Illinois to Alabama, talking to funeral directors, death care entrepreneurs, designers, cemetery owners, and death doulas about the changes they are seeing and in many cases promoting. I also spoke to people on the street, like Trevor, who were willing to entertain my almost taboo questions. What do you think happens to us after we die? And what do you want done with your body? This book's premise derives from a long tradition of mortuary archaeology. Material evidence of how a society treats its dead can yield powerful clues about that society's values, beliefs, and day-to-day life. This reading of material clues represents a grandiose type of forensics, like Sherlock Holmes reading the psychology of criminals in the cigar ashes they accidentally left behind. Unlike Holmes, an archaeologist can never be entirely certain that they have read the evidence correctly. This book makes no claims that the interpretations offered are the only ones, nor does it offer a complete survey of all that is happening in death care. My focus is on human remains, what is being done with them, and what people think and feel about them. Another horizon of big change, both in the United States and internationally, is digital death practices, from video-conferenced funerals to online memorials and several forms of virtual afterlife. These developments have been well studied by others and fall outside my scope. Rather, I'm interested in material afterlives. I take an archaeological approach to contemporary life that uses ethnographic interviews to zero in on the ways in which people relate to objects and landscapes. Traditional archaeologists have to make educated guesses about what artifactual evidence means, but doing a mortuary excavation of the present gives me the advantage of asking people on the ground what they think is going on with the changing face of American death. They aren't always real sure either. We fumbled through our questions and answers together. This work is the result of a collaborative dialogue between me and dozens of interlocutors about still emerging phenomena. Its findings are necessarily speculative, but not unfounded. Only after sifting through our conversations and putting patterns into historical context did I start to have those aha moments that give me the courage of explanation. The conclusions I have come to, and will share in what follows, are more profound and moving than I ever anticipated. The 5 years of research that inform this book involved tracking down people who are innovators in death care or who had professional opinions about where things are going and why. I followed hunches and word-of-mouth suggestions. In extended interviews, often with the same person over a period of time, I collected stories about the individual's life and work and sought to understand the context and events that informed their death work. I did not gather opinion surveys or statistical data. That type of information doesn't get you very far in trying to understand why people do the things they do. While some listeners might find some of the new death options I describe here outlandish, my intent is not to entertain or to shock. My anthropological orientation means that I want to get a sense of collective trends and shared concerns while staying alert for disagreements, diversity, and undercurrents. I could have written a different book focused entirely on the most spectacular, tabloid-worthy death rituals involving celebrities, or John Doe getting buried in his Cadillac, thus making him a posthumous celebrity. But that would give the wrong impression that the new death options I'm interested in are eccentricities rather than meaningful cultural practices. I also did not look at medical donation or cryonics because these represent less than 1% of dispositions in the United States. The vast majority of Americans are buried or cremated. Even though I met some colorful characters on this journey, I think of them as representatives of a larger whole. There is no such thing as a typical everyday American, but the people I have sought out are not doing what they are doing just to get attention. They are cultural influencers, but not in the superficial sense as hawkers of goods. They are tapped into the undercurrents of a desire for something far more significant, a cosmological readjustment. People often ask me if I wanted to be an archaeologist when I was a little kid. I didn't. I wanted to be an astronomer. I have thought a lot about this recently because of the number of times people have said to me that we are just stardust returning to stardust, or something like that. They may not realize that they are paraphrasing Carl Sagan, but maybe he was just paraphrasing common sense. In many cultures, like the Swana of South Africa or the Onondaga Iroquois, individual stars in the sky are thought to be the souls of the dead. One of the effects of our bright urban skies is that it makes it hard to see the stars, as if there's a population decline among the dead. In the summers of my childhood, I went barefoot most of the time. My feet touched the earth. They were often dirty. I made mud pies. My family went camping several times a year, and I slept outside under the stars. We couldn't afford a tent, but I didn't mind, and I didn't know any better. Dirt and stars, those were the stuff of the lucky parts of my childhood. Somewhere in there is the firmament of my current path. My favorite excavation unit is a 1x2. That means it is 1 meter wide by 2 meters long. If I'm digging in a public place like the French Quarter in New Orleans, people like to ask, "Are you digging a grave?" It makes me self-conscious, like maybe I am doing something macabre by digging up history, moving the fragments of past lives around and making them into new things. But maybe that's what all of us are doing, in our way. You never know how deep an excavation unit will go when you start. We dig down until we find no more traces of human activity. Where I usually dig, that means sometimes 3 feet, sometimes 6. In some parts of the world, you can go dozens of feet and still not run out of traces of people who lived thousands of years ago. My favorite phase of an archaeological project is when I can tell the crew to go home as we're coming close to finishing an excavation unit. I get down into the hole, sometimes with my shoes off. I scrape the dirt clean so you can see the different layers of time more clearly. I take photographs and make drawings of what I see, an accumulation of lifetimes. It is dark and cool in the trench. The smell is calming. You can tell that things are simultaneously growing and decaying. And time slows way down. In the process of researching, filming, and interviewing, I have met some unusual people and many kind ones. They included thoughtful people doing life-affirming things, like surfing or running a marathon, who stopped to talk to us. I encountered born-again entrepreneurs, visionary proselytizers, quirky makers, and staid traditionalists. Perhaps surprisingly, people's willingness to reinvent death did not skew along the polarized political lines that have defined American public life for the last several years. Some choices might be preferred in blue states more than red ones, but political persuasion did not reliably predict who was willing to get creative with death, and in this way, to work through what they value in life. The COVID-19 pandemic hit as I was drafting the last chapters of this book, but I had already become convinced that there is a collective existential crisis going on in the United States. People are struggling to figure out what it means to be American in the 21st century. It is a struggle happening simultaneously on the spiritual and political fronts. For some people, it means becoming more individualistic, more entrepreneurial, more materialistic, but perhaps counterintuitively, at the same time, more spiritual. They give no signs of worrying about a contradiction. For others, it means a return to older, pre-industrial ways of doing things, when we were less alienated from nature, our bodies, and our communities. And then there are those ready to toss everything out and invent radically new approaches that involve reconfiguring our relationships to the dead and to the planet. They want to tear things down to the rafters, to rethink what death means in both physical and metaphysical terms. Postmortem options are proliferating, sometimes pulling in opposite directions. But there is no question that there is a quiet revolution going on, and its roots go all the way down to who we are and why we're here. All this ferment is relatively new. Throughout the 20th century, American death practices were remarkably conservative and also weird. Mitford was right about that. Embalming, viewing, and a concrete cemetery vault constituted the standard American funeral ritual, often regardless of the religious or ethnic background of the deceased. Until quite recently, embalming was rarely practiced in other countries except in the case of public figures lying in state and bodies needing to be transported across borders. Many observers have interpreted the American tradition as emblematic of a national tendency to deny the reality of death. Esmeralda, who makes natural fiber shrouds for green burials, told me that in the 21st century we are witnessing the death of denial. People are craving authenticity, and anything left of artifice is being blown apart. This craving for authenticity suggests that there is a problem, a void begging to be filled. The denial of death is a key theme in existential philosophy. Ernest Becker was a remarkable anthropologist, philosopher, and scholar of psychiatry who published a book by the same title in 1974. Becker argues that Freud was correct that a good bit of human character develops through denial, repression, and transference, but he was wrong about which animal fact of our being is the source of the problem. It is not sexuality, but mortality that makes us all a little crazy. Having the conspicuous capacity to predict our own deaths, we go through all sorts of mental and cultural contortions to act as if it isn't going to happen. We struggle to control our terror of it. Becker points to death denial as the source of many human problems, from anxiety disorders to the compulsion to make war. Coming at it from a neo-Freudian angle, he arrives at the same conclusion as existential philosopher Martin Heidegger did in his magnum opus, Being and Time. Accepting the inevitability of death will make us free. Becker's thesis about the denial of death is a sweeping, universal one for all of humankind. From an anthropological point of view, that might be its chief weakness. But social critics who were already pointing to some strangeness about American death rituals in the 20th century took it up as validation. If humans in general tended toward unhealthy habits of denying death, then Americans were overachievers. Jessica Mitford had already made this point in 1963. Elizabeth Kubler-Ross tackled the problem as a clinical one affecting terminally ill patients in her highly influential 1969 book on death and dying. It was she who gave us the stages of grief model that has become a mainstay of pop psychology. Denial is stage one. If Americans have been especially prone to denial, The implication was that they were stuck in a kind of arrested development when it came to death. Eminent scholars concurred. In the 1970s, French historian Philippe Ariès published his own magnum opus on attitudes toward death in the Western world that has become a model for analyzing death through the lens of cultural history. He divided Christian European death into five phases. The tame death of the early medieval period was one in which death was considered natural, reflecting the conviction that the life of a man is not an individual destiny, but a link in an unbroken chain, the biological continuation of a family or a line that begins with Adam and includes the whole human race. The second phase, the death of the self, marks the beginnings of a more pronounced individualism in the late medieval period, continuing through the Renaissance and the Reformation. The moment of death became a dramatic and anxious rehearsal for the day of judgment. People believed they were going somewhere in the afterlife, but worried about which destination. Remote and imminent death characterizes the Enlightenment of the early 18th century. With the foundations of Christianity shaken by secular rationalism, the forecast of an afterlife became uncertain and death more frightening for its potential finality. However, beginning in the Romantic period of the early 19th century, Ariès says that some amelioration of this collective existential crisis appeared in the form of a new focus on enduring love between the living and the dead. The next world becomes the scene of the reunion of those whom death has separated. It is the paradise of Christians, or the astral world of spiritualists and psychics, but it is also the world of the memories of non-believers and freethinkers who deny the reality of a life after death. In the piety of their love, they preserve the memories of their departed. This phase came to full fruition in the Victorian death cult, with its almost obsessive preoccupation with memorialization through mourning clothes and jewelry, fancy cemeteries, the invention of the obituary, and post-mortem photography. Finally, Ariès identified invisible death, marking the colonization of death by science and industry. By the early 20th century, family members were no longer the primary caregivers of the dying and the dead. More and more deaths occurred in a hospital setting, and professional funeral directors took over all manner of death arrangements, from collecting the body to erecting a gravestone. In Ariès's view, the new Western faith in scientific medicine's ability to repair the body meant that death came to represent a public failure as much as a private grief. Death became dirty and embarrassing. Outside the professional sanctuaries of funeral homes, communal rituals started to break down. In the United States, embalming rapidly took over as standard practice, and the corpse was sequestered in morgues, funeral homes, and suburban cemeteries. Ariès viewed 20th century American funeral practices that he observed in his own lifetime as an extreme case of this phase, calling it a society that behaved as if death did not exist. Americans were the supreme deniers. But Ariès was a historian, not an anthropologist. He didn't actually watch people as they went about performing death work or mourning, nor, as far as I can tell, did he talk to anyone about it except other experts. He observed from his writing desk. That kind of distance can introduce distortions. But it is certainly true that over his lifetime, fewer and fewer people witnessed loved ones in the dying process. And fewer still, outside war veterans and those in certain professions, ever saw a corpse until it magically appeared in an open casket, the picture of sleepy peace. It is also true that even though medicalized death was growing throughout the Western world, embalming and viewing made the United States stand out as a bit odd. In the popular imagination, the idea of American death denial has recently become a kind of self-critique, inspiring new efforts to overturn this supposedly unhealthy state of affairs in the 21st century through what has been christened the death-positive movement. Caitlin Dowdy, perhaps the movement's most prominent spokesperson, created the popular YouTube channel Ask a Mortician in 2011 and established the advocacy and thanatology group Order of the Good Death. Dowdy has published two popular books in which she contrasts the dysfunctional American way of death in its dominant form to more positive funeral practices in other cultural traditions that she sees as better at confronting the truth and messiness of death. Many of the practitioners and entrepreneurs I sought out consider themselves members of the death-positive movement, or early pioneers who made it possible. And almost everyone I interviewed is grateful for its educational work, even if not enthusiastic about all of its tenets. While the death-positive movement is an important side story to what I relate here, for a couple of quite different reasons, it fell outside the center of my focal lens. First, the more I have delved into the history and practices of American death rituals, the more I have come to question the death denial thesis. I don't think Americans have ever denied death more than anyone else. In some ways, in fact, they have confronted it in bold ways, including through their death rituals. The confusion may derive from the ways in which Americans have long dealt with death that blur the lines between materiality and spirituality. Just because profits and commodities are involved doesn't mean that a funeral rite is soulless. Nor does professionalization necessarily lead to estrangement. Dead bodies around the world are often taken out of the hands of family members and turned over to ritual specialists. That doesn't mean that the fact of death is being covered up in these belief systems. It means that some expertise may be needed to ease the transition between life and death. Somewhere along the line, these errors in logic crept into narratives about American death, and they have been hard to shake. I posit that once we stop leaping to judge practices as death-denying, and stop assuming that capitalism disenchants everything, even the afterlife, then things start to look a little different, and super interesting. The second reason the death-positive movement is not at the center of this story is because it was late to the party. Many of the practices promoted by death-positive advocates were emerging a couple of decades before the first social media platforms introduced them to a broader public. The death-positive movement is finding a ready audience. It is answering and amplifying a cry for change that was already rising. A major source for that cry is the hospice movement. Modern hospice practice started in the United Kingdom in the 1960s and quickly expanded to the United States. In the 1980s, end-of-life care had become so accepted that it was added to Medicare benefits. The original aim of hospice was to provide medical and emotional care for the terminally ill. It has expanded to help dying individuals understand their options and take control over major decisions that affect quality of life for both themselves and their loved ones. As a result, hospice has moved increasingly from hospitals and long-term care facilities to the home, and the dying often take an active role in planning their own memorials. With home hospice, the dying and the dead are returning to the family. The rehoming of death has become so important to American family life that one of the most painful aspects of the COVID-19 pandemic covered by the media in 2020 was the isolation of dying patients in nursing homes and sterile hospital wards. This recent negative experience is likely to boost the home hospice movement, which has already played a major role in making death visible and intimate again, reversing the cultural shift that REA observed for the mid-20th century. The hospice movement has reinforced the idea that one has options.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.